Hi guys, my name is Solomon Jagwe. I am a 3D artist and animator originally from Uganda, East Africa, but currently I am based in North Carolina, United States of America. And today I want to share some new features and some other improvements in the hair and fur modifier. There's some features that I'm really stoked about, and I couldn't wait. I mean, I've seen other applications like Hair Farm, and you know, also Shag Hair, and also the Hair and Fur in Maya. But this is 3D Studio Max that I'm gonna be sharing with you. And by the way, for those of you who don't know where Uganda is, we are here in East Africa, so I mean, there's been an uproar over the two Konit video. Right now, I'm not going to talk about that, but this is where Uganda is, East Africa, and I'm in North Carolina. Okay, just give you a quick geography lesson. All right, back to this hair and fur modifier, which is really cool. Okay, here, what you're looking at is a render that I did of a 3D model that I'm working on for a short wildlife conservation film. It's targeting the raising awareness to the plight of the last mountain gorillas. There are about 786 left in the entire world. And so I thought this would be like a perfect case study for the application of the hair and fur modifier. Now, mountain gorillas don't have hair because they're animals and they're covered by fur. So anything that has like hair all over its body, chances are you're gonna have to refer to it as fur. So that's what you'll be looking at. Humans, we have hair. So we put like hair on top of this. Okay. Here's another quick render. This is the model without the hair and fur modifier. And this model is about, let's look at, it's about, 19,000 polys. So in the gaming world, that's relatively low poly. So you can, that's why I was able to go crazy with the hair count, but most of course I wouldn't recommend you using so many hairs unless if you really have a low res model. And if the moment you add hairs up to this count on a high res model, you're gonna see a big hit on your system resources. So right here, this model, right now the hair modifier is disabled, so that's why I'm able to see the animation. I rigged this model inside of Motion Builder and imported it into 3D Studio Max as an FBX file. Now, what has been improved, of course, is the interoperability with Maya Motion Builder, where you can send this file to Motion Build and then bring it back quickly. So when I add like extra or new animations of this mountain gorilla running around, I'm able to bring this back even after I've applied this modifier. The hair stays in those the selected polygons without losing all the hard work that you put in. Can you imagine trying, selecting all these polys, finding a really cool, collection of parameters here that you can put onto the mountain gorilla, and then you bring your animation and poof, it disappears. I mean, that would be so, I'll be mad. I probably want to punch the monitor. So I'm really happy and excited that there's that interoperability between 3D Studio Max and Motion Builder to make it easier to apply or save this scene and just keep importing the animation as an FBX animation add, as opposed to replacing the entire file. So what features am I excited about? One of them is clamping right here. I think I need to first of all get out of that mod, and then we go to clamping. Now, this wasn't there in our previous versions of 3D Studio Max. So specifically, you know, you're able to increase the number of clamps, and you notice I'll bring up a render that I did. So around here, around the shoulders, you're able to almost like hairs that have been pinched, you know, that gives you that nice clamping to give it a more realistic look. And I'll bring up another render. I think that will be able to show you some of the other, you know, appearance of the clamping. And that is a feature that I think many people who use the hair and fur modifier are going to find very, very helpful. You can change the strength, the rotation, and you'll be able to do like quick renders. Now, just something to keep in mind, there are a number of changes and improvements to the hair and fur modifier. I'm not able to go into great depth of, you know, what each feature is, but I'm just going to pick out the ones that for me I've been looking forward to and I've seen in other hair and fur, you know, plugins for, you know, for Maya, even Cinema 4D, Blender, you name it. And actually the introduction also in ZBrush, they've just added some fiber, you know, feature in there. So those fibers can actually be brought into 3D Studio Max, and the splines, you can recomb or style this model using those splines. So anyway, a quick overview again of this modifier is that what you do, you start off with a model like this, and then you go to your modifier list up here, and you look for the hair and fur modifier, right? So you click on it and you apply it to the model, and the next thing you do is you go into the polygon mode. Okay, so what you do, you I had this turned off, so I have to enable this back on. And then what you do, you go into the polygon mode and you select the polygons that you want the hair and fur modifier to be applied to. And then you click update selection here. Seconds to update. Okay, so with the guides selected, you can then use those guys to comb the hair, you know, once it will follow the direction of wherever the brush is going. And after you brush the hair, you can then come down here and say recomb, and automatically it will recomb according to the direction of the splines. And when you're done with that, you can say click on finish styling. And you can see how the hairs are styled accordingly. Okay. Now, if I did like a quick render for this one, just to see, you know, what it's going, it looks like. Okay. So as you can see, with the styling that we just did, and the hair settings that we picked, because then all these are dependent upon what values that you enter here, and a lot of this you're gonna have to do, it's a little bit of a trial and error just to get the exact look that you're looking for. But after you get it, you definitely have an option to save these settings, so you don't have to, you know, use them again or lose them, and you have to start from scratch. So what you do is, after, you can create your own preset and give it a name, and you say okay, and then you, if you wanted to start from scratch, you know, like if you wanted like a different kind of hair, you don't want to start from nothing, you can also load a preset. And 3D Studio Max comes with a collection of these presets. Now, these are some of the ones that I've created, but as you can see, you are given like a starting point almost similar to what Maya has, although I noticed that in Maya My has gorilla. So I wish they had, created one. You know what? I'll probably create my own called Solomon Gorilla. Yeah, how about that? Anyways, so without having to start from scratch, you can use these guys here and just click like one of these. Maybe that one kind of looks closest, like fuzzy brown. Okay, you can double click on it, and now you have a new hairstyle or fur hair and fur style. So make sure you use make use of these presets. Now, excuse me about that. And the other feature that I really wanted to point out was the material parameters. Squirrel. I don't know if I'm saying it right. Like an African squirrel, you know. But this one gives you like a nice fade. When you do render it, you get like a quicker fade from the root to the tip. And when you choose a tip fade, so that's a nice addition. And you can also do materials. You can apply materials to the slots. Like if your character, for example, had a material, like one texture map, then if you chose the tip color as a map, you would be able to use the texture map to control the appearance of the hairs that you've applied to the model that you've been working with. Same thing applies to the root. And another one is the flyaway parameters. That one is, you can have hairs, you were able to generate like stray hairs that stick out from the rest. And that is again another feature that that has been added, that is going to improve or actually increase the efficiency in how people apply the hair. But anyway, if you're like me, you're like, okay, you know, there are all these cool features, but what can you do with them? You know, what would the end result be once you've applied? Because I know you're going to put in a lot of hours, you're going to put in a lot of, you know, trial and error, trying to find out, you know, what correct, you know, dials or values do I need to get to the point where I have like a hair sample that I really feel like this is working. You go in and maybe change color or the tip color, you know, to look like that. You go in, but after it's all said and done, you know, you want to see a cool render. Now, here's something that I have that I made with this one. Okay, let me play this back so you get an idea of what it's like once you've applied it. Yeah, baby. So anyway, it took me a while to finally get the right look and feel for this mountain gorilla, you know. But once I found it, you know, it gave me a really nice feel and look that I hadn't had before. So it adds a, you know, realism to the model, and also to the, once you've rendered out this video, you're able to have like a nice, you know, something that is really convincing if you're trying to tell a story with a hair, because you know, ultimately hair is not just creating hair for the sake of creating hair. You're trying to convey an idea. You're trying to convey how soft, how scruffy, or how, you know, maybe old or young this character is that you've made. Now, if we go back to 3D Studio Max, something else I wanted to point out is that, yes, actually, if you notice that in this video, when I play back, the hairs are not moving like the... you see some plants are moving, but the hairs are not actually responding to the forces, the wind forces. So I'll show you another example. And actually that feature is down here under dynamics. So you can set the gravity and then you can click, select like a range of how far you want the animation to go, and click run. It will go through and create a simulation of, and again, it will depend on if the character is animated or not. If it's not animated, you would need to put like a wind force to blow the hairs around. But in my case, because I added gravity to the hairs, I was able to create hairs that actually respond to the body movement of the mountain gorillas. And that one looks like this. Make sure it's not running. Okay. Let me turn this off so maybe have like less memory usage. And this is the one that I made. Now, what I did was I exaggerated a lot of these features, rather the settings, so you could get a better sense of what it's like when you add gravity and to see how it's animated. So here goes. So in here you can see how the hairs are actually colliding with the body of the mountain gorillas. And these settings that of course I've used, I tried to make it as loose as possible. This is like an extreme end, you know, mountain gorilla fur doesn't move like that. It's a little bit more thicker and it has more clamping. But this is just an extreme to show you, you know, how when you do the dynamics, how the hairs will actually have the collision detection, because then you apply the collision to the source object where the hairs have been applied. But that's what has really got me excited about, you know, the prospects, you know, all kinds of things can be used for, you know, this hair and fur modifier. So I hope you've enjoyed, you know, this feature. And hey, this is my website, sol.com, and galuango.com is the website where I'm actually working on this animated film, and I'm trying to raise awareness to the again the plight of the mountain gorillas. A lot of them are killed so as trophies, as bush meat, but a lot of it is also inadvertent traps that end up, you know, capturing these guys when they are trying to run through the jungles. The poachers set traps made for other animals, but the mountain gorillas, because they share the same habitat, get caught up in that. And I really thank Autodesk for giving me the opportunity to share this, the fur, you know, hair and fur modifier. And you can see how cool it looks. And also with this other example, without the simulation and dynamics, so it could be used for birds, for deer, horses, like horsemen, and grass blowing in the wind. That's what I had to share with you. And so these are some really cool features that have been added to the hair and fur modifier. Of course, there are many things that you have to look into with all these icons, but again, I'm just showing you a quick preview of what has got me really excited about the future of the hair and fur modifier, and being able to stay inside of 3D Studio Max and doing all this, you know, with the dynamics and, you know, the effects. It's gonna make for a more complete, you know, solution for animation and hair and fur simulation. Thank you so much again. Take a look at my website when you get a chance, and, you know, help me out. Together we can make a difference in raising awareness to the plight of these last remaining mountain gorillas, the last surviving mountain gorillas. And hey, we can study, we can learn a lot about them from maybe like hair solutions. How about that? And don't forget also to support the rangers, who do a great job of protecting them. And of course, other local communities like the Batwa tribe that are affected by deforestation and charcoal burning and all that. But anyway, this is not about wildlife conservation. The main feature was about hair and fur. But it just so happens that hey, you can actually make a difference using this some of the features in 3D. You know, how cool is that? That 3D can actually help make a difference, you know. So thank you, Autodesk.